Well, our next guest helped take British music to a whole new level with the Moody Blues, and the world absolutely loved it. Here are some of his biggest hits. Nights in white satin, never reaching the end. Letters I've written, never meaning to send. I wish that I was flying with them. Now you're not here. Once upon a time, once when you were mine, I remember your skies reflected in your eyes. I wonder where you are. We're so lucky to have him right here in the studio. Let's welcome singer, guitarist and composer for the new Moody Blues, Jonathan Coleman.
Yeah.
Welcome. Oh, welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you very much. You're
so
very kind.
Cool, don't you?
Your leather jacket.
Look, those 60s rockers, they knew what cool was. They invented cool.
What's it like being part of the 60s and 70s music scene? Do you remember much? Do you remember much of it?
I know I was there because I've seen the pictures and I'm in them. Yeah. But it was rushing past quite quickly.
Yeah, what a time to be.
It was a great time to be in London, to be quite honest, you know, and to be part of that. I was very lucky to be part of that scene.
Swinging London.
Yes, it was a great time for musicians, you know, after the Beatles opened the door. For everybody, people like me, anyway.
But you were one of those acts that sort of transcended. You sort of started with that mod look, and then you ended up sort of in the art rock world as well. I mean, a lot of bands around that era fell by the wayside, where you guys kept going and kept putting out great albums.
Well, thanks.
I'm sorry. I've been waiting 25 years.
Let Mikey do the rest.
I'm a bit of a fan, Mike.
Oh, thank you, Mikey. No, I think it's just we never kind of were part of any trend or any fashion, and we were lucky enough to be with a label that was run by rather elegant elderly old gentleman in Decca, who just said, get on with it, we don't quite know what you're doing, but people seem to like it, you know. So we didn't have to make hit singles, we were able to make albums.
Well, but hit singles, Nights in White Satin, you hear that song.
Who'd have thought that would nobody said that was going to be a hit.
It's such a fantastic song.
I mean, it's
still in the charts. It's still a massive hit.
It still resonates with people, but it's the audience that brings the magic to it every night.
It's interesting that it keeps being re-released, and every time it's re-released, it gets onto the charts.
Yes.
Do you get sick of people talking about Nights in White Satin?
No. Do you know the curious thing was that a soul singer called Betty Lovett recorded it about 3 years ago, and somebody sent it to me one morning, and I listened to it, and I really got quite emotional because I'd never heard the song. I wrote it when I was 19, but her version is the first time I'd really heard it as a listener.
Betty Lovett.
This is Mikey's best day ever.
She's a fabulous soul singer.
As a 19-year-old.
I was about 19 or 20. I can't remember exactly.
And it's such an unusual song. And your whole sound was not a typical 60s sound. It wasn't the kind of...
Okay.
You were sort of doing your own thing very much.
Yes, that's right.
Was that... You were talking about how Decca kind of left you alone.
Yeah.
And that was the label who famously said no to the Beatles because guitar bands
were
on the way out.
Yes, that's right.
They said, we're not going to screw that up. We're just going to let you do whatever you want.
No, I think they saw the Stones and said, we're not going to mess this up. No, I think it was the great days where record companies had recording studios, big recording studios, great quality recording studios. So we got a lousy royalty, but we got to make lots of records.
And speaking of which, how did you sell them on the idea of War of the Worlds? I actually played the grooves off one copy and had to buy a second copy when I was a kid. Because if those of you who don't know, it's like a concept album based on Jules Verne's War of the Worlds.
That's right, the H.G. Wells story of the War of the Worlds, yeah. Well, it was conceived by a guy called Jeff Wayne, a friend of mine, and he invited me to be part of it. And that's been a great gift to me, the song Forever Autumn.
Yeah, great song.
Go anywhere in the world and play it and people know.
Look at your hair. Yeah.
I know, look at
do
it. Look
you
at
like his hair. Yes. You've still got the lovely flick going, but wow, what do you, when you see yourself there, what do you think?
Too much hair lacquer.
No, but yes. Memories of that time, do you sort of think, oh, wow?
I was lucky, you know, because you first mentioned the 60s and I wasn't really paying attention in the 60s. It just went by me, and I was lucky to have that opportunity like 10 years later and through the 80s as well with Wildest Dreams, and to be able to really be aware and in the moment and present with it all and enjoying it all, yeah. Like you boys and girls are now. It's your time. See, and you enjoy it.
Can we talk about the solo album?
Yes, of course, yeah. Thank you.
Is it a different pressure going in as a solo artist than it is going in with the band?
I can say different things. Mm. You know, I can just talk about things that are really personal to me and relationships that are unique to me, because I'm not saying we, I'm saying I, really, yeah. About it. And that's the difference, yeah.
So what's I? What's important? Now.
Relationships, people that I know, people that I'm very fond of and that I have known. We all go back to childhood and our early years, mm-hmm. and the people that we loved and, you know, the romances that we've had. And there have been a few in my own life, but you turn to those kind of emotional experiences, and I'm very lucky to just be a guitar player and to be able to
And do you still
play
mix
them.
With the older groups from that time?
You run into all the boys and girls from that time.
I was very good friends with Led Zeppelin.
Yes.
The group. But John Bonham was a great mate of mine.
The best drummer. Yeah, powerful,
best drummer ever. And do you still mix out with some of them?
You run into them. It's not like the old days where you would have like five or six acts on the bill and you'd see them kind of just around the dressing room. But yes, we run into each other at kind of awards for still being around shows. You know?
There's no old champs already.
Do you remember Donna Coleman?
But we have you're right, we have something in common, yes.
Yes, that's right.
And you are, do you remember Jono Coleman? Was he a roadie at any point in time for you?
I was in the first moodier blues I was in.
You played the triangle.
Okay.
Yeah. Justin, I tell you what, you still owe me 50 quid, all right?
Was that what it was? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. How much is that worth now?
About 5,000.
Yes, exactly.
What
for? Funny.
I can't say what it's for, Sarah. What goes on the road stays on the road.
Fair enough. Now, you are touring here, Justin, as a solo artist for the first time in Australia.
Yeah.
What can fans expect?
I hope there's something there for everybody. I mean, obviously I do solo things and I do the big things from the Moodies as well, but I try to do things that are kind of deeper album cuts that people really have known, but I've never done on stage before, and quieter things. And I'm with two great musicians with me, and a young boy called Mike Dawes, who's a brilliant young guitar player. And it's a privilege to be part of their journey as well. You know, two younger people with me.
You might want to write this down, Mikey. Justin has two special shows in Sydney and Melbourne this week.
Yes, I do, yeah.
Tomorrow he's at the State Theatre in Sydney. Yep. You can book at ticketmaster.com.au. And on Friday he's at the Athenaeum Theatre. You can book via Ticketek.
Two great venues.
They're great venues for a fabulous bloke. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.